Kia ora koutou, nō mai, hara mai, welcome to this fireside chat on decolonising solidarity with Dr. Kem Gambrell and Dr. Clare Land. Wonderful to have you all here this morning. I just want to begin our time together with some words from a blessing that were adapted by Mitzi Nen, a long-time anti-racism activist and advocate for Te Tiriti o Waitangi, Pākehā woman who has guided many of us, Pākehā particularly in our work here. So some words to bring us into this space and this conversation. May we be blessed with discomfort at easy answers, half-truths, and superficial relationships, so that we may live from deep within our hearts. May we be blessed with anger at injustice, oppression, and exploitation of earth and its people, so that we may work for justice, freedom, and peace. May we be blessed with tears to shed for those who suffer pain, rejection, hunger, and war, so that we may reach out our hands to comfort them and to turn their pain into joy. And may we be blessed with enough foolishness to believe that we can make a difference in the world so that we can do what others claim cannot be done. So, those words to guide us, and again, welcome to you all. I'm Jen Margaret. I am Pākehā based in Te Whanganui Atara, and really grateful for this conversation happening. Clare Land, who is joining us, has we've collaborated together on work around in my book, Working as Allies. And Kem, I've just recently met, but know that she too is doing really exciting work in this space. Before we do anything more, I just want to remind us of the community code. And so just if you've been to other sessions, you'll be familiar with this, but just some guidance for us all this morning in terms of having our curiosity and recognizing that collectively we know a lot, but individually no one knows everything. Those other encouragements for us in our time together this morning. Also, just a reminder about the great work that is happening in terms of the ability to access the live captions for this session. And so the information is both in chat and on your screen for doing that. We have Emma here who is in the background doing the important work of moderating. So as you go, do encourage you to ask questions in the Q&A or to share anything that you want to in the chat, but particularly if you've got questions, pop them into the Q&A. If you find that you're in the lobby at the moment, do please jump into the actual meeting so that you can participate in the chat and the Q&A. And so just in terms of this session this morning, I'm going to let Clare and Kem introduce themselves fully, but just to acknowledge we all will be as non-Indigenous people on Indigenous lands. For me, acknowledging mana whenua both here in Te Whanganui Atara, Te Atiawa and Taranaki Whanui, me Ngāti Toho Rangatira hoki, but also mana whenua in all of the places that you might be joining from this morning. Tēnā koutou katoa. So, in terms of how the session is going to run as well, this is a fireside chat. We were just talking earlier about the weather and all the different places that we're in, whether we actually need a fire at the moment or not, where we are, most likely needed by Kem. But the idea is that I'll be posing questions to Clare and Kem, and hopefully we have a bit of a flow of discussion, and obviously interested to hear and for you to ask things as we go. So just to start with, I'd like to invite, thank again, Kem and Clare, for your work and for your willingness to participate in this amazing event. I should also say to the incredible people who have done all of the organising, and Erica, who's helping with this session flowing today. It's a great gift that you are bringing to all of us, so kānuitu mahi kia koutou. So, Clare and Kem, would love to you both to sort of start with just sharing a bit about who you are and the work that you're currently doing that brings us to this conversation around decolonising solidarity. So we'll start with you, Clare, just to share a little bit for starting.
Okay. Thank you, Jen, and thank you, Heather, and all of the organisers. I'm joining you today from Wurundjeri, Woiwurrung land. I'm a non-Aboriginal person, so, you know, of a colonial background, and culturally I'm Anglo. I've been active in supporting and particularly learning and sharing learning about Aboriginal struggles in this land since about 1997, and particularly in association with Gary Foley, who I met then, and Robbie Thorpe, a local amazing political leader. And I'm still working alongside Gary Foley, so and in association with Robbie Thorpe and his family in many different ways. But I work at the Indigenous Academic Unit of Victoria University in Melbourne, Mundani Balak, supporting the development of research. I teach also, and particularly teaching sort of out of the book, Decolonizing Solidarity. The research I do is responsive to the research priorities of Gary Foley. So that's where he works as well, at Victoria University, and he has his archive there, an amazing, amazing archive of his activism and as well as just all types of actions that Aboriginal people have taken in resistance from the 1920s onwards. So I also help to resource the archives through grant writing and different things like that. And in my activist work, I'm a member of the Pay the Rent Grassroots Collective, as a member of the administrative arm of that.
Kia ora, Clare. Kem.
Wonderful. Thanks for my letting me be here. It's an honor to meet everybody and be part of this conversation. My name is Kem Gambrell. I'm currently residing in Spokane, Washington, which is in the northwest corner of the United States. I'm occupying Spokane tribal lands, both original ancestry and current ancestry. My original work was with the Sichangu Lakota, which is a Plains tribe in central United States. My initial awareness and relationality was grounded in things like working with work release incarcerated Native men and supporting them in their spiritual rights. So that's where I got started, and now being in the Spokane Territory, my more practice has been teaching non-Aboriginal or non-Native people in terms of research, how to be a good researcher in terms of solidarity and communityship and those kinds of actions. So deeply influenced by both Plains Natives here in the United States and now Coastal Salish tribes.
Thank you both, and thank you for the work that you're doing, and acknowledge all the people that you know, that give you guidance and support in that work. Before we get into sort of the more of the details of the decolonizing solidarity conversation, I'm interested if you can just both highlight, and this is probably quite a difficult question to do in any succinct way, but some of the recent kind of political context for both Australia and the US in terms of, you know, coming into this conversation around decolonizing solidarity. So again, Clare.
Yep. Top of mind is the recent kind of contentious and ill-fated referendum on whether there should be a voice to Parliament, a voice of Aboriginal people to the federal Parliament. That referendum lost, and there was a big no vote for that, about 60-40. And that that was tied in with two other things that so voice, treaty and truth were three things that the government, the Labor government had come to power promising. So the I'm all in favour of truth telling. Victoria itself actually has a treaty process underway, so it's several years underway in its planning, and other states have undertaken to explore a treaty as well. However, the loss of the referendum has then emboldened the Conservatives in most states to step back from treaty promises, including in Victoria, mentioning that without watering down cultural heritage laws, they will not be keen to support a treaty. So it's that I'd say that's the political context, but for Aboriginal people on the ground, there's just a massive issue is still just over incarceration and deaths in custody, which just continue, and so there's a lot of campaigning around that at a grassroots level.
Yeah, kia ora, Clare. And for you, Kim?
Yeah, so the United States is, of course, different than New Zealand and Australia in terms of relationality and things like our treaties with the Native tribes and with the U.S. government. Our biggest contentions right now, and we were talking before the session started, but our biggest contentions are this very deeply conservative movement in the United States to not just continuing to negate the treaties that many of our tribes have with the government, but even more so just things like diversity, equity, and inclusion practices within higher education and organizations, and even undermining curriculum in higher education, say around critical race theory and those kinds of things. So we have a precarious nature in the United States right now in terms of our politics, and it'll be interesting to see who gets elected, because if we swing back deeply conservative, a lot of the things that I just heard Clare speak about will probably be happening here as well. If we continue to stay our course, hopefully these small incremental movements that have been going on in the last few years will continue, but November is going to be an interesting time for us as well to see how much of our policy we can continue to move forward or what continues to get undermined, if you will.
Yeah, and just recognizing for us here in Aotearoa how we're in this space at the moment, and that word precarious is probably very relevant to hear, and as well as obviously the potential of a similar situation to the referendum, Clare. And so for activists here, obviously important kind of learnings from those contexts, but also just those real concerns and realities that are really very harsh in terms of the attack, those attacks on Indigenous peoples and Indigenous rights have been there since colonization in all of these places, right? But just how they're manifesting right now in that intensity. Yeah. So useful to have these conversations across different contexts for sort of learning and understanding really how we can strengthen our work of solidarity in these times. And I suppose also recognising that it's not like before we got into these super hostile times here in Aotearoa, at least, that we were all sort of sorted in being, in any of this stuff. So not that you ever are, but, so it's just this, I think there's kind of this layering of this context of hostility around still needing to pay attention to the work that you talk about in Decolonising Solidarity, Clare. So In terms of some of those key concerns and insights from Decolonising Solidarity, just interested to know about what some of the things from that, from Clare's work, that resonate for you in your context, Kem.
Yeah, not a shameless plug, but if you haven't read Clare's book, it's wonderful, and please consider it. One of the things that Clare, that you talked about, and I'd love you to continue to expand on, is you talk about the discrete binary that we often get into about Indigenous, non-Indigenous, Aboriginal, non-Aboriginal, et cetera, and that really limits the complexity of who we are as beings and how we're showing up in places and spaces. So I thought that was a fun conversation, and I'm curious, knowing that you have another edition coming out, how you're making sense of all of that now.
Yes, and that's the chapter that I'm trying to rebuild, just because I feel like it was the least sort of accessible chapter for the readership and the audience that the book has spoken to. And yeah, it's just that sense of, okay, the colonial mindset, the colonial structural, logic in Australia and settler colonies is you've got colonizers and the colonized, and the whole point of settler colonization is to eliminate Aboriginal people, to eliminate Native people. And so it's really important to understand that structural binary and to position yourself and to know yourself and what is your relationship to colonization. Being on Aboriginal land means that you have a relationship, whether you're Aboriginal or non-Aboriginal or a blend of those two. And or if you're a migrant who's arrived in Australia much more recently, even a tourist will have a relationship to colonization. So it's important to understand that colonial mindset, but at the same time, try to pull a way of being out of that colonial way of seeing things, in order to think about, who are we in the struggle and whose interests do we serve? And that's probably the most important thing, is whose interests do we serve and whose law are we committed to upholding? So those become important, but it's not something that I would discard. That binary thinking is not something I would discard at all. It's something to have, that's important to come to grips with first. Many people in Australia have never thought of themselves as settlers or as being part of the colonial process. So without thinking in those terms up front, then you just got no way to analyse the situation politically. And in terms of treaty, I've just really, just being excited. It's exciting for me to learn more about Aotearoa and the notion of either being tangata whenua or tangata tiriti. Whereas here in Australia, it's just absolute obliviousness about those things, generally speaking, unless you're an Aboriginal person.
Yeah, that's great. And I think you're intimating what's part of my second question to you. Sorry, I just got a tickle. But you talk about kind of this reconstructing of whiteness that I think it was a really powerful insight. And that was, in my mind, as I was reading it, I think sometimes white allies or people that are interested in social justice work that come from a wider Anglo perspective paradigm feel shame and judgment about that. And I thought you did a nice job of talking about sort of reconstructing that notion of what it means to be in relationship with others. So any more there that you want to talk about?
I guess it's tapping into a debate about, do you abolish whiteness, or do you try to just be white in a different way, or at least not be whitely? And you can be whitely without being white. You can have those ideas embedded in you as a person of color. Reconstructing that, moving from one place to another within understanding your structural location. But and white people often have a problem, find it really difficult to see ourselves as members of a group, so members of a white, being white, and can't, and if we're told to to understand that, then we think it means we can't be also our own individual story, journey and struggle is lost or something like that. So I guess that's why I want to wear this t-shirt today. I don't know if people heard about our Sam, one of the best footy players, soccer players in the world, recently charged with racially aggravated assault in the UK. And it turns out she called a cop a stupid white bastard. You know, so racism, this is not reverse racism. Racism is about time, place and history. And so, you know, I guess trying to understand what race is, what racism is, and how history matters, and I guess what whiteness is as a historical, political, and, you know, ideological, I guess, result of colonization.
Thank you. Last thing that I'll say, and open to your thoughts on this, and Jen's as well, but you gave a whole chapter, in essence, about the history and unpacking the space in which you were doing your research, which I thought was really powerful in the United States, and specifically where I've the groups that I've worked with, of course, place and space is huge. It's deeply important, and it's part of their relationality and their ontology and epistemology and so forth. And to unpack that entire history to say, as you were intimating, Clare, this stuff's complicated. And to think about even the language that we use through a historical sense, and what did it mean? Where did it originate from? How did those understandings rise? And then how do we use that kind of language today, and what does it mean? I think, again, as part of the complexity that I'm not sure very many people do. So any thoughts there?
Yeah, I guess the book, Decolonizing Solidarity, it's written in relation with a particular political community and a particular political lineage of Aboriginal people in the southeast of Australia, and the struggle for land rights, the health movement, the community survival movement, I feel that the insights from the book can be applied elsewhere, but the historical chapters kind of show that, you know, you need to know the context. So by revealing the context here and what that context means for the politics of solidarity, it can be then applied hopefully in other contexts through also seeking that same knowledge of history.
Trying to update it at the moment, which is quite overwhelming. I'll get it happening pretty soon.
Yeah. Thank you. I think speaks to just the differences, even though there are things to consider. And you mentioned Linda Tawahi Smith's work with decolonizing research methodologies, but that those sort of concepts can be used, but I appreciate, and Jen, if you were going to speak to it, that is, you know, those sort of contexts are really, really important as any of this work is done, and things that, especially those of us that say don't have that historical knowledge, that doing that work is very important.
Yeah. I was just going to ask Clare if you could speak a little bit about any of the other things that you are particularly updating in the second edition.
So I guess for me, the feedback that I got academically from the book and from some activists and community members, you know, like, it was a people mainly tell you that, oh, the parts they liked, and, you know, I don't usually get the negative feedback as directly, but one really important response to the book was from people of colour, saying, well, what are the politics of solidarity by people of colour? And I thought, oh, fuck, I've managed to re-centre whiteness with this book. Mm. That's just, like, so ironic and so not the aim of the book. But, the opportunity presented by having to do a second edition is to more clearly articulate and elevate the politics of solidarity by people of colour,
with Aboriginal struggles, and that's been done through collaboration with a fantastic activist and now and scholar who's revised the book, Sunil Munon, who's revised the book from that perspective. And also just trying to reflect a bit on decolonizing as a buzzword in a way. Obviously the title does pay homage to Linda Tihiwai Smith and even previous works, but it has been taken up so widely that it's sort of, I guess the question is does it still mean what it was intended to mean then? And so just considering what I've learned over the period since the book about what is the potential or the meaning of decolonising, in particular in a settler colonial context. So we'll just explore that a little bit in the new edition.
That's awesome, Clare. And just to acknowledge actually in the chat that there's some reflection about learning here from Asians for Tēnō Rangatiratanga, inclusive Aotearoa, and so those networks here that have, someone in their chat is talking about the learning that they've done from that in terms of solidarity. And there's also a question, so just if you recently joined, a reminder that you can post questions in the Q&A, and we've got a question in there now, so I might just pose that to you both. And so the question is just wondering how you have seen decolonial pan-Indigenous solidarity in each of your contexts emerge and evolve in relation to the Palestine Liberation Movement, and whether there are particular challenges you have to confront in building transnational decolonial solidarities in Australia and the US. So,
yeah, I mean, I can probably speak more easily to the first part of that question, which is that there has been a very, very strong, unequivocal, outpouring of solidarity by Aboriginal people with Palestinians. And Gary Foley has been a very, very strong, consistent voice on that, well, for 50 years, but and continuing particularly since October the 7th. And he's there's been weekly rallies in Melbourne of that, but it's also been expressed, over many years through other ways. There has then been a politic around that. There's been a couple of Aboriginal people speaking out against the association between Aboriginal struggles and Palestinian struggles. That has been reported from where I sit, there is just a very strong, grassroots connection. And this year's Invasion Day rally, on Australia Day, the National Day, 26th of January, that was actually combined the weekly Palestinian rally with the annual Invasion Day rally, and it was just an incredible event. And those bonds are created by dialogue and connections between members of the crowd. Those persist, and those are really, strengthening and empowering for both sides, from what people's testimony about that.
Thanks, Clare. Kim?
I have not seen a large pan Native movement against what's going on in the Middle East. Absolutely, as Clare's discussed, there's a number of individuals that I've seen work to speak out against it. And I would say also just the inhumanity that's going on, not just in Palestine, but also in the Ukraine, as an example. So not anything in terms of a large collective movement, but absolutely individual activists speaking out against those sort of atrocities.
Thank you both, and thanks for that question. And yes, yeah, that encouragement for others to add your questions as we're going in this conversation. Just wondering, Kem, if you can talk a little bit about your work. So you do research in leadership and social change, and if you wanted to share a bit about that work and how what it offers in terms of, you know, particularly thinking what it offers to both Indigenous and non-Indigenous people in terms of understandings of leadership, who exercise it, whose voice should be used, and when.
So as a leadership scholar, what I found over the 25 years that I've been engaged in leadership as a learner, scholar, teacher, et cetera, is that we tend to use a very Western individualistic notion of leadership. And that is that it's an individual, usually an older man, for lack of better, that has power and influence over other individuals. And part of what my work has been focused on is, I would say, a much more holistic relationality to group and community, which from my observations and engagement with specifically the Sichangu Lakota has shown. And so instead of thinking about leader equals leadership, a lot of my work has said, well, what does it actually mean to be in communityship? Which means that everybody has influence, everybody has voice and positionality and influence into, let's say, the group or community well-being. Of course, because so much of leadership scholarship is centered on the Western individualistic notion, where it's much more power over versus power with and shared power, cracking these things open through a lot of the spaces, say, that I operate in terms of higher education and working predominantly with white Caucasian individuals, is to invite different ways of thinking about power and about positionality. So a lot of what Clare was already talking about, which was why I was appreciating some of the terms that she was using in her book. But while originally my work was with Sichangu Lakota, and again, with men that were on work release, trying to find ways to practice their own spirituality, what I understood fairly early on was the oppressive nature of the larger system. And Clare intimated this, but of course, in the United States as well, we incarcerate people of color at much, much higher rates than we do white people. And then we tend to penalize them more severely as well. So in working with incarcerated men that were in work release or working on their way out, allowed for me to understand better and then gain better relationships in terms of how these dynamics look, especially, again, trying to influence how white people think about this thing called leadership and communityship, but also then when we engage in conversations around this policy and practices, even in terms of our own research, how do we start trying to decenter ourselves when in reality, that's usually about all we know for a long time until we start practicing other ways. So that's where I'm thinking about things now and my pathway there a little bit.
And are your students or communities that you are working with, how are those ideas, I suppose, growing and being enacted beyond the academic environment that you're in those discussions? How do they go out into the communities?
So a lot of it, as somebody that oversees a lot of dissertations, so doctoral research, a huge part of it is then asking my students and those I'm working with is, what is the intentionality of your research and who is it for? And again, Clare sort of intimated some of that. But to understand that research isn't just about me because I'm interested in something or I think something is really cool, but rather that social scientists, our actual intent is to go back into our organizations and communities and help them, if you will, do better, to be more inclusive, to help a greater range of people thrive. So we ask our students a lot to do things like, what really is your positionality? So to crack open all sorts of identities around power and influence and assumptions and biases and those kinds of things, and then go back in when they're doing their research with whatever place and space, if you will, that they're doing, what does that look like there? And what assumptions are you making in your research? Is that research needed because you think it's needed? Or is that research that the community is rising as a collective need, which again mirrors a lot of what Linda DeWayne Smith and other Indigenous researchers ask for, is we don't just do it because it's interesting to us, but rather, is it actually contributing to community, and how do we know it's contributing in a good way, if you will?
Mm. Yeah. Any reflections you'd like to share? Clear?
Yeah, yeah, certainly. I've been learning so much about research in the last 5 years. After the book, I asked Foley what I should do next, and he said, tell the Northland story. So that was the top priority research program to that he wanted to see done, drawing on his archive. And it's a big story of race discrimination by the state of Victoria against Aboriginal children and their access to a relevant education. And so I worked particularly closely with members of the community around that school who had built the school culture that had created this conducive environment. And through the influence of that collective of people, the research sort of swiveled away from my idea of what the best, I guess, Western research has to offer of, like, you know, participatory action research, oral histories, a reference group to guide the research. But it's still kind of an extractivist kind of way of doing research, is getting people's stories and then weaving them together and then publishing a book at the end. And, you know, hopefully there'll be impact that flows from that years later. I mean, the intent was also always from Foley that there should be a book, but there should also be a stage show. So that he said you have to do the story and it has to be a stage show. So, but the main aspect of the research that I've learned about is, I guess, understanding what research is from an Aboriginal worldview, and research as knowledge practice, and the research was something that had to particularly speak to an Aboriginal audience, but also the process of the research had to actually benefit people all the way along, not sort of something that would happen later. Me understanding that this was not a research project, but it was the next chapter in the lives of that community. And it continues now because we have a truth commission in Victoria that we hope that to put this story in front of as well. So it is continuing on. But what it's given me a little bit of an identity crisis as well about what I am. Am I a researcher? And also being in academia full time now, am I a researcher? Am I an activist? Or am I this idea of accompanying as a researcher, I guess, is something I'm drawn to at the moment. Mm.
Are you an activist researcher?
I hope so. Yeah.
Well, yeah, does it? Do you feel like you can be that, not an either or, when you ask that question of yourself?
Yeah, and I tuned into another session from conference about that. It was fantastic. Anyway, yeah. Yeah, I think I guess it's always a question of, like, what can I do? How can I be part of, you know, advancing, you know, justice and struggle? And how do you do that in the university? Do you invest into building the Indigenous academic unit and building the opportunities for Aboriginal students and staff? Or is it more a case of using whatever resources you've got to, you know, resource sort of work with community members outside of the academic space? Probably a dilemma to continue to grapple with, I think.
And I think that's always, you know, that core part of doing this type of work, right? That we need to be doing that core work of changing white systems and processes and focusing on our own people who either can be encouraged to be brought along for change or at least neutralized so they're not barriers to change, at the same time as directly supporting in responding to the calls from Indigenous people to be directly supporting struggles and doing the work that you've both done. You know, you're both doing that work across both spaces. Mm-hmm. There's lots of questions in the Q&A, so if it's all right, we'll go to a couple of those. Firstly, just an acknowledgement, all of these questions, people are acknowledging your both of you and the awesome work that you're doing. One here about your mention, Clare, of collaborating with people of colour in terms of the in scholars to revise Decolonising Solidarity, and just some interest about what might be being said in that revised version about that people of colour solidarity with Indigenous peoples. Don't know where you're up to with the revision, so whether that's something that you can speak to yet or if it's still in development.
I mean, Sunil's definitely done all his part of it. Now it's just waiting for me to revise parts that from my perspective as well. So but yeah, just very clearly that you know, that people of colour are settlers, and that so that binary is still, it is a thing. You can't assume that that being a person of colour, that there's a natural affinity or a natural sort of, you know, political analysis that people will have. And so, you know, there are parallels. I mean, some of the politics are the same as the politics relating to that should guide white folks. But that there is, you know, there are nuances to that. I know in other settler colonial places, you know, it has been a different history of enslavement. In Australia, we did have slavery and through Pacific Islanders being forced to come to Australia. But then we did also have the White Australia policy for 70 years. So we did deliberately try to create a white-only nation. So it does, there is a different history, and you know, people being forced to go to Australia to, you know, as being enslaved, you know, that means that you haven't come with a colonial purpose, you know. So those are the sorts of discussions that end up in the book. But I guess there's some examples as well of how folks of colour have hooked into the solidarity movement over time. So that finds its place in the history chapter to elevate that more. There are some fantastic collectives of anti-colonial Asian workers and African solidarity collectives. So yeah, there's certainly grassroots expressions of solidarity that abound. So yeah, that's a little preview.
Thanks, Clare. And a question for you, Kem. A reflection from one of our participants, Patty, who said that she's watched an American journalist, Chris Hedges, talking about the difficulty of accessing privatised prisons and how do you deal with the prison system and work with Indigenous peoples, you know, in the context of even those issues of access and within prisons. So just if you could share a little bit more about that work that you've done.
Yeah, that's a great question. Most of the work that I've done is trying to help people be successful coming out of prison. So mostly in terms of spiritual rights and so forth. And what I found is, even though we have, say, legislation in the United States around religious rights, that inmates still have access to that, especially in terms of things like Sweat Lodge, which is Plains Indian way of practicing their spirituality. It's very difficult to do that in certain contexts. So it's not a great implementation of religious freedom and access, if you will. So how to help individuals have access to that and offer support systems and so forth to that. Usually that's meant, again, relationality and holistically. So in the work that I've done, that often means involving their families and finding space for that, that those folks like that are on work release and so forth can have access to for that short time that they're out. But the prison system here in the United States, to the participants' question, you know, it's tricky. And again, November will be interesting for us because there's a huge movement on the far conservative side to privatize prisons and education. And so if we do that, then what will that mean in terms of outcomes and guidelines and consistent policies and practices? So it's complicated.
What up? And just another question for you, Clare, that again, Patty asking a friend, did her thesis using poetry through storytelling. Do you know of other researchers or other types of research who that don't use that extractive approach? And any, I suppose, that you're drawing on in the work that you do?
Fantastic PhD candidate with us at Mundani Balak, Kathy Travis, has done a project that does seek to benefit Aboriginal community members as the project, which I guess is then documented in the thesis. So it's sort of a creative project with an exegesis that theorises the process that's been done. And what she did, she's impacted by the stolen generation, so the separation of children, Aboriginal children from families over three generations. And so she's done her own process of reconnecting to the full details of that story through the colonial archive. She did that as an honours project, and then with her PhD has done that through offering to accompany two other families to try to, as they access the colonial archive, and because it's, you know, I'm reading records written about your family by those who've been colonising your family, it's such a traumatic process and really confusing as well. So so her project has involved that work. So I just love that she's reinventing what it is to be an academic, and I find that really, really inspiring. Yeah, so certainly lots of examples coming through.
We have a couple of research methodologies too that are, let's say, newer and upcoming. So Sarah Lawrence Lightfoot came up with portraiture, which is much more of a method where we're in deeper relationships. So it's less about being an observer, you know, like a Western philosophy would utilize, but much more about writing sort of a collective narrative, which I think is really powerful. And a little what I hear you talking about, Clare. And so in those writing of the portraits, the other participant or participants are reading that too and making sure that it's in alignment with how they make sense of the world and their worldviews and so forth. So there's other research methods out there that can be used, I think, in solidarity with some of the things like Smith and Sean Wilson and others recommend in terms of accountability and responsibility to the, you know, to the community and to the research, if you will.
Awesome. And Clare, can you just mention again the researcher whose work you were talking about?
Kathy Travis, Paola Balla as well, a colleague at Mundani Balak, you know, she does practice-based research, so she's also working in that similar kind of way. So these are Aboriginal women researchers, so it's particularly Aboriginal people's knowledge practices and research practices that are you know, leading the way.
Thank you both. I'm just going to pick up on one, well, kind of weave a couple of the questions together that are remaining, and one is actually about reflections on sort of on self-interest and settler self-interest. But I'm going to join that into a question that's around allies using, well, learning in relation to Indigenous language and cultural practices, and the inherent tension between learning so that you can be normalising, supporting and appropriate and engaging with the ongoing sort of erosion and takeover of Indigenous languages and culture by colonists. So just any reflections you have about how you how you walk with that or navigate that?
Yeah, absolutely. That's a tension and a really thoughtful question to engage with. I guess my guidance for a couple of decades has been from Gary Foley saying, don't approach me as an anthropologist. You know, like we're over it. We don't want to be, you know, we don't want you to hear to find out about my culture. And he would always direct us as non-Aboriginal student activists to learn about Aboriginal political struggle. So I've always, for years and years, focused on that and not tried to rush towards finding out about culture. I'm working within a cultural space now, and so it's becoming clearer to me, how Aboriginal cultural values are enacted within spaces. When you're in a space in which Aboriginal cultural values are the norm, that's really unique in Australia, and it's probably different in Aotearoa, given the mirage and different spaces that people have like that. But in a way, the decolonizing work here is creating and then having to defend creating spaces where Aboriginal cultural values and norms govern the space. I am learning more about that, but I guess as guidance for perhaps newly involved supporters of Indigenous struggles, I guess the guidance is to learn about difference as opposed to learning about the other, about that person Aboriginal culture as, something of, that you want to find out. And that kind of settler interest, I guess, is, that people want to have an experience. And that's not really what this should be.
Anything you would add, Kim?
Yeah, I think Clare said it really well, and maybe just to land a point that I hear her talking about is, what is our intent when we go into those spaces? And is it to borrow or again, I don't know my own culture, so I'm going to learn about yours to fill in gaps, then that's, probably not the right intent. But I also am aware that when I go into certain cultural spaces, if I'm there long enough, I'm going to naturally have things, let's say, slough off on me. So, greeting words and those kinds of things. So how can I think about what is being, let's say, freely offered in relationality versus what am I taking or trying to take or inadvertently taking?
Thank you both for those reflections. And it brings us back to what you've echoed, I think, quite a lot through this around that necessity to constantly be reflecting and asking who's benefiting, who am I, and is this for my, for my benefit to make me look good in this space, or to be focusing and strengthening the work and justice for Indigenous peoples. Yeah, thank you both. We just have a few minutes left, and so I would just invite you both either to add something that you really wish that I'd asked you already, or I think it'd be lovely to hear a reflection from you. You've both been involved in this work for a really long time in hostile environments. And so any reflections about how you maintain hope, which is actually a thing that we have to work and cultivate, or continue this work. So any reflections from that?
Do you want to go, Kem?
I think for me, Jen, is, you know, again, we've been talking about the continued political tensions in the US, Australia, and New Zealand, is to realize that, you know, it's lifelong work. Things like the mindset of colonization and racism and so forth have been around a really, really long time. And so they're probably, unfortunately, not going to be solved in our lifetimes, but how to do the both and I recognize this is a bit of a statement of privilege, but how to continue to do the work and be in solidarity and in good relationship with folks, as well as understanding it is the long game, and so that there needs to be a little self-care about it. I know that Clare does a great dance in her book, again, about sort of that juxtaposition of not being laissez-faire, or recognizing when we can step away and that not everybody has that privilege, but also being around long-term activists in the United States, like Angela Davis is an example, you know, really recognizing that the self-care for the long game is important in there. So it's a muddy tension, and one I think we just need to continue to hold center.
Awesome. Clear.
I guess what one thing that gives me hope, there's just this, you know, fantastic organisation called Bupuk Willem Aboriginal Child and Family Centre here in the northern suburbs of Melbourne. And they are just so aligned with the old school community survival, community controlled lineage that the book is written in relation to. And it's sort of grown out of the Aboriginal community controlled health movement. So it's a holistic, amazing centre. There's also one called Dadi Manwaro here in Melbourne. And these are spaces where, as I said, where cultural values are in the fore, but also that politicised leadership of those places, which are so savvy about how to defend those spaces, and so they will turn down funding when the funding is going to be diverting them from their purpose, and they'll just proceed, they'll just survive, they'll persist. And I find those really, really inspiring. And I think that you know, it's just that always the tension between, you know, for me and also for Aboriginal activists, like we've mentioned it in the book, like what is the strategies? This should Aboriginal activists focus on trying to encourage non-Aboriginal people to get their act together and not be as racist. So if there wasn't so much racism, then things would be easier for Aboriginal people and organisations. Or is it better to invest in community members and, grow those spaces, grow those decolonised spaces, and projects and organisations, and then invite people in who are respectful of that. So, that inspires me, seeing those spaces grow. Mm.
And Claire, just as I'll be doing some closing things, there's a request from Grace, who's in Melbourne. She'd love to have those names of the organisations that you just mentioned. But if that's possible for you to pop those into chat. But I'd just say to thank you both for those final reflections too. I love that muddy tensions expression, and also clearly pointing to the really important decolonising leadership and spaces that that Indigenous people are growing despite all of this, despite all of these environments. And so just that acknowledgement of all that work and acknowledgement of the work that both of you do and the conversations that we have had today. Kānu te mihi kia kōrua. Really grateful for your work. And just to acknowledge too, mihi nui kia koutou, all of you who have come to this session, your interest in being here, really important at this time to acknowledge the 40 organisations who are backing this amazing event. So thank you to all of them. And to encourage you as well, tomorrow is a big day. It's called a marathon for racial justice. I would have thought this whole event is a marathon. Maybe tomorrow is the sprint amidst the marathon. But Te Mura o Te Ahi is happening tomorrow. So an encouragement to join those interactive talks from students and recent graduates who are pushing the boundaries in anti-racism in Aotearoa and internationally. Most of the recordings from these sessions will be uploaded to YouTube, so do please share them. And also, in many of the sessions I've been in, people have been wondering if they aren't already engaged in things to respond to the current attacks here in Aotearoa on Te Tiriti and Māori. Then do sign up to the Action Station petition. It will be a place where, particularly in relation to the Treaty Principles Bill, there'll be action sort of opportunities through them. So thank you again for all being part of this, to the organisers and the moderators and of course our speakers. I just want to close this today with some words from Dr. Huirangi Waikereperu to guide us on our way. Ko mutu a mātou mahi mō tēnei wā, manaakitia mai mātou katoa, o mātou hoa, o mātou whānau, aeo ki te aorangi. Our work's finished for the moment. Blessings upon us all, our friends, our families. Peace to the universe. Kia ora koutou.
Thank you.